Start. So let me remind what I said the last day. So we are dealing with systems which are Hamiltonian and are close to integrable. So we have systems of this type. So first a zero, which is integrable, and then a perturbation, which is small. So here epsilon is a small parameter, right? So we had the equations of this Hamiltonian, it's phi dot equal to derivative of I of h0 I plus derivative, sorry, epsilon derivative I of h1, and I dot is epsilon minus derivative of phi of h1. So what we said the last day is that when this parameter is zero, the system is integrable. So the I's were just first integrals, and we wanted to know what happens when we add this perturbation to see whether these I's were or not first integral. So here, for me, so phi it belongs phi to the n torus. I belongs to some set and t belongs to the torus. So inside tn cross rn cross t. So I post two versions of the Arnold conjecture about Arnold diffusion. And today I'll state the results that partially answer them. So first, it was the weak form that was, so let me call star to this kind of Hamiltonian. For a typical H1 of this type, there exists an orbit phi of t, I of t, such that the actions for this orbit deviate for some constant C independent of epsilon, right? This was the first version. And, this, and the strong version was that fix two open sets V1 and V2 in the action space, so in the in B where the I live. Then again, for a typical Hamiltonian of this type, it has an orbit phi t I t such that the orbit starts in one open set and finishes in the other one. Right, so these were the two conjectures. And here again, here typical, it's very imprecise, obviously. One needs to choose which typicality, I mean, works out to prove theorems, right? I mean, one would like this to be generic, for instance, in the classical sense, but what I'm going to present is it's for a much weaker notion. So the first theorem, which is by Patrick Bernard, by Dean Kaloshin and Kezang, I think it's 2011 or 10. So they say the following. So sorry. Before I present it, let me define SR, the unit ball of Hamiltonian functions CR. So CR functions which with a CR norm equal to one, okay? So then the theorem goes as follows. So there exist continuous functions L and epsilon zero, which go from this unit ball of CR perturbations to R, which are positive in an open then set U in this unit ball, okay. Then if we define it, later I'm going to make a picture because it's quite involved, this statement. So that if we define V, which is the perturbations epsilon H1, where H1 belongs to this unit ball, and epsilon is between 0 and epsilon of H1, then for for some set W inside V, which is open and dense, the corresponding, so for, let me say, for epsilon H1 belonging to a subset of V, which is open and dense, then for the corresponding Hamiltonian system has an orbit phi t I t such that the deviation in actions from some time t to the original time is larger or equal than this function L of H1, which is positive in this open set. So let me write, let me explain the theorem. So first, so this L is something which is positive, and it's independent of the parameter, but can be very, very small. So we just have some deviation, but can be extremely small. And then let me write, let me explain this kind of typicality that they use. This is called, Matter called it CASP residual set. So this was introduced by John Matter. So the picture goes as follows. So if we take the SR, the unit circle, then in this first part, we need to exclude some bad points. So we have, let's say, here some bad directions, which we don't know how to deal with. But the complement, it's open and dense. So this part here would be U, which is inside SR and is open and dense. And then from this set, now what we make is we consider these H1s in U. Sorry, this should be in U. So for the H1s which are good, the ones we know how to deal with, we multiply them with epsilon below epsilon 0. So in this, so if this is 0, these bad directions are the ones for which this parameter goes to 0, so they are forbidden. So then here, what we get is that we need to exclude some sets close to the bad directions, right? I mean, because epsilon 0 goes to 0 when we approach this bad direction. So we need to exclude these CASPs. And then what we get here in the complement, it's what is called V. And then from this V, we need still to exclude some points. So we need to consider an open and dense subset of points. And this is the one, the ones which we know how to prove this deviation in the action. So here, we need to exclude some bad sets, but which are very small. And then for the complement, we know how to deal with things. This definitely it's weaker than generic in the usual sense, but that's the class of sets that we know how to deal with. Okay. So So if we remember the picture we were doing the last day, and this is for any dimension. Eh? I mean, this is so here. So this is true for n and a half degrees of freedom for any n, okay? And it can be also for any n, I mean, for the classical autonomous case. So if we remember the picture of the net of resonances that I did the last day, so if we were considering the frequency space, recall that we had some lines which correspond to frequencies omega, such that omega times some k in Zn was equal to zero. Then here we get some single Tesnan lines and double Tesnan lines. What they do is they obtain here some small segments of size L of H1 through which they can diffuse, through which they can obtain change in the actions, okay? So now let me answer the second theorem, the strong version of Arnold conjecture.
Is that what you should
do? Sorry, thank you. Thank you very much. So, yes, thank you, Ed. So, sorry. So, for both forms, we need to assume that H0 is strictly convex. Okay, so, and that's, yeah, that's fundamental. This to be true. Otherwise, this is at least not proven. I mean, so recall the second conjecture says that let's take two open sets. So since this is convex, recall that we had that omega I, which is the gradient of H0, that's a global diffeo. So I'm going to be talking about actions from frequency. I mean, they can be basically identified. We can go from one to the other. So if I take two sets, say, in frequency space, V1 and V2, I want to find a path through resonances which go from one to the other. So we want the actions to move through resonances to leave one open set and reach the other one. So for the strong form, we only know how to prove it in the n equal to 2.5 or 3, so 2.5 or 3 degrees of freedom. Okay, so it's open in higher degrees of freedom. So what we take is we take a sequence of resonances gamma kj, and this, so is this just points omega such that, well, or i's in B such that omega of I times kj is equal to zero. So we consider a sequence of such resonances so that the first one intersects the first open set. Some last one intersects the second open set, and the consecutive ones, they also intersect, right? So it's precisely the picture I've written here, right? It's this. So would be this one and this. So this would be gamma k1, gamma k2, and so on. So we consider a piecewise smooth path gamma star, which is inside the union of these gamma kj's, connecting v1 and v2. Okay, so what we'll do this theorem is to prove that there is an orbit which sort of follows the sequence of resonances from one set to the other. Yes. Yes. And this will depend on the path. So the theorem goes as follows. So it's fixed gamma star. Then if you want, I mean, just not to write all this. So for a, let's put it for a cusp residual set of epsilon h1, and this is just precisely the same as before, and now it depends on gamma star h1. So then h0 plus epsilon h1 has an orbit phi t I t such that I0 belongs to V1. IT belongs to V2, and this is for some capital T, which is large. And then actually, for all time from 0 to T, the distance from the from this IT to this path of to this Thesnan path is smaller, or equal of a constant times the square root of epsilon. So here we have a small neighborhood along these resonances, and we know that our orbit stays close to this tube, right? No, with this proof, no.
Or at least in a compact region of a residual set, or the intersection of a residual set.
Well, I mean, this, residual, it's not residual in the usual sense. I mean, there are all these conditions and all these kind of small perturbations than what needs to do to attain this, which was in this subset of the subset, and all these transformations, depend on gamma star. I mean, and all the conditions.
The finite number of gamma star.
For a finite, yes. For for any gamma star.
I'm saying that whether maybe there's a count, if you consider a countable set of gamma star, still there is something that we need.
It should. I mean, you always need to be careful that you don't end up with a empty set. But for countable,
if you put a countable number of gamma stars, maybe you have
that. That's yeah.
True, but the same equation is basically intersection of residual, countable residual. The problem is that the epsilon start to have some variation with the gamma star.
I mean, definitely, if you keep adding resonances, your epsilon zero shrinks to zero. So you need to be very careful of the way you're doing things. Actually, the next theorem, we use infinitely many resonances, and what we get is much weaker than this in the sense of typicality.
I have a question say that so if you fix some row, for example, yeah, depending projection of action space,
it relents. I'm going to say this.
But also in the angles, I mean the whole solution is the whole space, or just in projection action?
No, I think it's just in action for the relents case.
Yeah, okay.
I think just in the actions, no? For the rodents case now, I don't see why you should get the same in the angles. No, I mean, it shouldn't be true, right? I mean, I think it's just in the actions. So I'm going to explain this later, but we will see that close to this resonances, we can build some cylinders which are hyperbolic, but of course, recall that we are in H0 plus epsilon H1. For this system, everything is flated by tori. So to prove here that we have some hyperbolicity, we need to do it with H1. So it's going to be more delicate. We need to take into account the perturbation. So this theorem, this one, let me say that this was announced by Matter in 2003. And I mean, announced, and he has done a huge work in this problem, and he has, I don't know which 10%, but he says like 80% of the proof is done. But it's, as far as I know, it's not complete, but I mean, he was the first one to announce this. And even if the approach of, so this is by, sorry, Kaloshin and Zhang, so the approach by Vadim and Ke, it's different, it's more geometrical than the one that Matter is using, which is purely operational, but many, many ideas in this proof rely on ideas from John Matter, and parts of the proofs are, I mean, even just the same, some concrete parts. Then Cheng also has a proof which is on archive, and Jean-Pierre Marco also announced a proof, and he has done some part of it, as far as I know. These two are basically just using variational methods, and the one by Marco is using more what they are called geometrical methods, which are more similar to what Vadim and Ke have done, and what I'm going to explain these days. So a way of rephrasing this theorem is to say that we have rodent orbits. So here one would keep adding more and more resonances until we get that neighborhood of this resonance, row half neighborhood of these resonances cover the full space. So then this theorem could be rephrased. So this is Vadim and Ke. So fix row positive, then for a cusp residual set, we have, if we take an, so there exists an orbit, such that a row neighborhood of this orbit of it contain the whole space. If it from 1 to 0 contains the whole action space, so contains B, which is the whole action space. So you just cover it with a finite but large number of resonances, so that if you take balls in the action space, you cover the whole space. But of course, as you were saying, Enrique, so I mean, this is fixed rho, then you choose epsilon. If you tend rho to zero, of course, this implies that epsilon tends to zero. So you can just use only a finite number of resonances, not countably many. So if we remember what was the quasi-ergodic hypothesis, that you get an orbit which is dense in phase space, this would be easy if we remove just rho dense by just dense, right? But this is open. So with Vadim, what we have done is, let's say, like a weak version of the quasi-ergodic hypothesis. So weak quasi-ergodic okay, so let me explain it. And again, we are always in the case that A0 is strictly convex.
In the other you don't need the strictly
convex. Yeah. I mean, this is true in all results I'm going to explain here, yes. I mean, it needs to be positive definite. I mean, the reason is that at some point we use fractional methods, so they need some convexity to to use them to prove things. So. Sorry. Yes, I mean that's stronger than non-degenerate in the cosmograph sense than in the that's stronger. I mean, diffusion should be true for non-convex case. I mean, for the non-convex case being, for non-degenerate non-convex, but this is open. I mean, this is only known for the convex case. So, so recall that we are with systems of this type, and that we can apply KEM theorem. Okay, so so call KAM eta to the invariant ori, so T omega invariant ori with frequency omega times k bigger or equal than eta over k 2 plus tau. Okay, so we know that since it's strictly convex, it's non-degenerate for epsilon small enough, all these tori persist, right? So what we have obtained is that we obtain Hamiltonians which accumulate to this set here. Okay, so let me state it. Where I have it. So fix R bigger than R0, and there's going to be some regularity, which, for the previous theorems, the Hamiltonians have to be CR, and R has to be bigger or equal than 4. For this theorem, R has to be bigger than some R0, which we haven't computed, but it's large, 200, 300, and fix some eta and to positive, which are going to give this KEM tori. And here, let H0 be strictly convex and real analytic. There exists a cusp dense set of H of epsilon H1s. So here we only get density, which is much much weaker than before, such that H0 plus epsilon H1 has an orbit such that if we consider the closure of this orbit, for all time, it contains this KGM to I. Okay, so this orbit is accumulating in this whole set of KGM to I, which implies, in particular, that it has positive measure, right? So the Lebesgue measure of this, I mean, of this KM tri, or of the closure of this orbit, over the Lebesgue measure of the full phase space, it's bigger or equal than 1 minus some constant T0 times eta, and this T0 only depends on H0, not on the perturbation. So here, what we get is that we get, I mean, for a, let's say for a dense set of perturbations, which is much weaker than the Kakaloshian-Zhang result, we get that our Hamiltonian has an orbit which accumulates densely to a positive measure of KM to I, so of a positive measure set in phase space, with a very large measure, meaning that it's almost a full measure. I mean, this eta can be taken as small as we want. I mean, the true KAM, what we get is this eta replaced by the square root of epsilon. That's what KAM says, right? That the measure of all tori which are preserved by KAM tori, sorry, by KM theorem, it's a full measure except some square root of epsilon term. So far, we just get something which is very small, as small as we want, but epsilon independent.
So it's for all these tori that are preserved?
Yes. No, so here the idea is, again, is if we are drifting along resonances, here, let's say here we get some point which is the day of Einstein, what we will do is to get a sequence of resonances which approach this day of Einstein number. So in the limit, this point will be contained in the closure of this sequence of resonances. I don't know if this is what you're, but I mean epsilon.
So you have the epsilon and it's for all the Diophant. This is what I was confused about. It's for all the Diophant time to write.
Yes.
There's some relation between eta and epsilon.
Yeah.
It's fixed.
No. I mean here we fix. We first fix eta.
The smallest condition.
Of course. I mean, it depends on.
What is this? You have a precise relation between epsilon?
I mean, so far it's just fix eta and then we did epsilon.
Okay.
I'm sure that this should be.
Some power?
equivalent to some power, which we don't know. I mean, I'm sure we cannot get square root, but I'm sure here we can get some power. But I mean, we haven't finished this yet, and we need to keep track of all the estimates in terms of eta to see what happens, basically. Yeah. I mean, again, as before, you exclude the cusps. And then here in the complement, you should check the dense set.
Just dense instead of dense?
Yes.
So at the end, it's a dense set.
Yeah. It's a dense set. Yeah. I mean, this can be replaced by a dense set. Yeah. Yes, and the reason is that, I mean, we need to. To obtain conditions for all resonances, we need to make so many modifications, and in such a precise way that we cannot do more. I'm going to talk about this more on the last lecture. If we just work with just work here with perturbations which are flat in the KEM tori, then we can say open and dense. Open and dense here. That if you start with H0 plus H1, and at some point we need here to make some extra perturbation to make things work, if this term is vanishes in the KEM torus, in all KEM tori, so it's kind of a Whitney topology, then it's open and dense. So we cannot touch things. I mean, since we are approaching the invariant tori, we cannot touch much things when we approach the tori, and that's why we just get density. Okay.
Suppose that you don't know the previous theorem, even that it proves. Suppose that nobody knows the previous theorem, the Kalojian set.
No. I mean this. Basically, it's built upon.
No, that's from the statement. No, you have your statement.
Yes.
And somebody say, the other statement is also a corollary of this statement.
Well, yes, because this is built on the other one. Yeah.
Yes. The row, and then you put finite number of this tori.
Exactly. Exactly, but of course, this takes infinite time, obviously, to get to the tori. To get just raw dense, you don't need infinite time. You just go through the fastest possible ones, fastest possible resonances. Obviously, to get positive measure, we need all time tending to infinity. No. Okay, so let me.
Here you have all your eta tau.
Yes.
K and tori. And then if you take the union of them, well, you have this measure with this error of epsilon. But if you fix only one, you can have at least.
Well, if you just fix one tori with this, you just prove that your orbit can accumulate to it, right? That in forward time, can accumulate to historians, can be pointing around, and with a negative time goes away wherever you want. This, of course, says that all KM tori are unstable. For one tori, what you would be saying is that they are unstable, meaning that in the past you can tend to it, and in the future you can go wherever you want. I would say it should have an empty interior, no? But
yeah,
no, this I don't know.
It's not for the statement.
Huh?
No, it does not follow the statement.
I mean, it's precisely this. I mean, that it contains, I mean, the complement of KM that I, which is here, it's just the I mean, following resonances. So it's a very small, I mean, what is here and not here, it's a very small set in terms of measure. It's basically nothing, right? No, this I don't know.
But in principle, it would be equal
set. Sorry?
No, it's true what you say. Maybe from the proof, you come from the fact that how you build the trajectory, maybe you come.
No, this I don't know. I don't know. Okay, let me say. A final thing. So both Kaloshin and Zhang and Guardia Kaloshin that I've stated were by for 2.5 degree of freedom systems. They can be given like in the same way for 3 degree of freedom systems, but only in the region of the phase space where, say, the third action is bigger than some c, bigger than zero. Meaning that you can identify the third action with time and then do the same. But of course, then, I mean, then here, if you get full measure, it's only in this part of the phase space. Obviously, if you have like the full sphere, let's say, if h zero is just I squared over two, definitely we don't know how to cover like almost full measure in the full sphere. It's only in the part where this condition is satisfied. Obviously, one could say, okay, I do this like with several variables and then we match them, but so far with the methods we are doing, it's not clear how to do it.
This condition is essentially like you have 2.5
degrees. Well, yeah, of course, yeah. I mean, that's what I'm saying. That this is saying basically that I3 is time. And that you can go from autonomous to non-autonomous and do the same. So it's not, it's not.
So why? I mean,
then. Because this Bernard operational methods needs a. No, well, but I mean, you can do it, I think, autonomously, but you need a system, a common system of coordinates where you do everything. No, sorry. So it's for an autonomous. So I mean, if you change to several non-autonomous ones, the variational method only works in one of these parts, because you need like a common system of coordinates in your where you want to work to prove that this forcing relation, blah blah blah, all these things work. So with his techniques, it's not clear how to deal with the full sphere in the energy space, I mean, of fixed energy. One would need like a different shadowing method to prove this. But, yeah. Okay, so the next few days are going to be, I'm going to be explaining the proof. So the first 2 days of Kaloshin and Zhang, so of only drifting along a finite number of resonances, and then the last day I'm going to show how to improve his results to prove this theorem here. So let me start giving some key ideas. So first, recall that we had, so here we have again, let me write this, so the system phi dot is equal to omega I, and this is just the gradient of h zero plus epsilon I h one of I phi I t. And for an omega for us is the frequency, and we wanted to drift along resonances. And recall that since we were in 2.5 degree, so 2.5 degree of freedom systems, omega is just omega 1, omega 2, and 1, and this one is just time. So that in frequency space, let me raise this distribution because it's terrible, we had two regimes. So first it was the single resonance regime. That is, it exists only 1k0, I mean, up to a scalar such that omega times k is equal to 0. And this, so if we write here omega 1 and omega 2, these are lines. So lines are single resonances. And then there are the double resonances, when there exist, again, up to scalar, k1 and k2, which are linearly independent. And both of them are, an omega, it's resonant for both of them. And these are these points here. So these are double resonances. So if we want to diffuse, let's say, along this path here, we want to deal with both regimes. But obviously, double resonances are dense in the single ones, right? I mean, if we are in a single resonance, just take omega, which has two rational points, again, you're going to obtain for another one. So here, you get a dense number of them. But what we will see is that only a finite number of them matter. So let me define this. So we define a k strong double resonance. So omega is a k strong double resonance if there exist k1 and k2 linearly independent, which with k1 and k2 below k, and as before, omega times k1 ki is equal to 0. Okay, so in this k, will be fixed later. The next day. So give me that we only care with low k double resonances, and therefore only a finite number of them, which means that here we will need to make, let's say, just some punctures here, but not many, and we will need to exclude some open sets close to them, and the rest of it can be treated just for a single resonance regime. Okay, so we will have two regimes. The first is the double resonance regime, which will be in order of epsilon square neighborhoods of k strong double resonances. And the single resonant regime, which will be, let's say, in a neighborhood of single resonances, excluding the previous ones. Okay, so these balls will be the double resonant regime. And then we will make some here in the complement. We will have this, well, this have almost the same color. We will look at the complement in the lines, in the resonant lines. And this will be the single resonant region. Okay. And they will be, significantly different. The one we will get the behavior and the dynamics we will be getting in one regime from in the other one. Okay. So today, I'm going to start talking about the single one. So when we just have one resonance, and I will continue the next day, and then the day after, I will switch to the double resonant one. So single resonance regime. So in this regime, what is going to be very important is that we will see that there exist some invariant cylinders
So in the double resonant is where you do the corner.
So yeah, I mean, you either go straight, in some of them you will go straight, and in some of them you will make the
corner. So you have the chance, so you can choose either to go straight or
yes. Yes.
And this is in the strong ones.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, even so, in the single one, even if here there are more resonances, they are so weak that it's much easier to go straight than to switch direction. And we actually only know how to, we only go straight. If they are, if both vectors, if K1 and K2 are, let's say, more or less of the same order, then, what Vadim and K proved is that you can switch from one to the other. You can either choose to go straight or switch. If one is much stronger than the other, at least it's not proved.
Okay.
And I don't, definitely it's much harder to turn to get the weak one. I'm not sure even if it's possible. I don't know. So the key ingredient will be invariant cylinders, which are what are called normally hyperbolic. So there are cylinders that in the normal direction, we get some expansion, function contraction, which is much stronger than the dynamics we get inside, right? So, this is the what are called the normally hyperbolic invariant manifolds, right? So that you can, if you have this cylinder, so this cylinder is C, is let's say in Rn, that your tangent bundle can be split in three invariant sub-bundles, the tangent one, the stable one, so how you want to E, S, and the unstable one, and here the contraction and expansion is much stronger than the tangent one. Okay, so these cylinders, they're going to be robust, and they're going to have invariant manifolds. So to motivate a little bit why these cylinders appear and why they are too important for Arnold diffusion, let me make a detour and explain what are they called, purely the a priori unstable systems, which were in, are in some sense a set of systems which are kind of, easier to study in some sense than the, what now we are dealing with. So let me talk about the Arnold example
priori.
So these are the first type of systems for which it was proven from diffusion. And even if they are different from what we are doing, they are, let's say, in some sense, good models for the single resonant regime. We will see that but what we get here is different from the one explained for the systems, but at the end, they have many features in common. So let me start with Arnold example. So it's the first example for which Arnold diffusion was proven. So for the first example for which deviation in actions was proven. So the example that Arnold found, which is very particular and has many particular features, which of course are not are not typical. But anyway, it's going to be important for us. So he considered this system. So first, just the classical integrable system. Then he added a first term, cosine of phi 1 minus 1 times epsilon. And then a second term, mu epsilon cosine of phi 1 times cosine of phi 2 plus cosine of t. So here, the main issues that he chose two parameters, the epsilon, which is very small, and mu, which is very small compared to epsilon. Okay, so this was the trick he found to be able to prove things. So here we have, let's say, three stages. So first we can see what happens when epsilon is zero, then when epsilon is positive and mu is zero, and then when both are positive. Okay, so here we have three steps to understand the dynamics of this system here. So first, if epsilon is zero, we just get something which depends on the action. So in this first case, it's very easy. So we get a system which is a little bit Arnold integrable. So the phase space is foliated by three-dimensional tori. Okay. But here, the smart point is that when in this second step, what we get when mu is zero, it just, so here we get, in this case, we get first I1 over 2 plus epsilon cosine phi minus 1, and that's just the classical pendulum, plus just an oscillator. And this is completely uncoupled, right? So what we get is that in these first variables, we get the classical pendulum. And here we get that 0, 0 is a saddle. In phi 2, I2, we just get still a system which is integrable, so I2 is still constant. Plus time, which is just doing bar rotation, right? If we look at the whole phase space and look at this saddle cross these two terms here, what we get is a cylinder whose vertical direction is I2. Here in the basis we have phi 2 and time, so this is. This is foliated by 2D tori. And then here we have the cobclinic connection of our torus. Right? So this is the pendulum part. So here I2, it's zero, so it's a first integral of the system. So here, final diffusion, it's impossible. I mean, you cannot diffuse in the actions. Nevertheless, here you have some hyperbolicity, even if it's very small, because is of order square root of epsilon, so it's weakly hyperbolic, but still you have some. So now let's see what happens when we add the full system. So let me write the ODE. So here phi 1 dot is equal to y1, phi 2 dot is equal to y2, and now y1 dot is epsilon sine of phi times 1 plus mu cosine of phi dot cosine of t. And I2, it's epsilon cosine of phi 1 minus 1, times mu, so it's times sine of phi 2. Okay? So this cylinder here, recall that it's given by the saddle, so by I1 equal to 0 and phi 1 equal to 0. If we look here at this ODE, still when phi 1 is 0 and phi 1 is 0, we get that it's preserved. So this extremely particular choice of perturbation that Arnold did makes that C, which is given by I1 equal to 0 and phi 1 equal to 0, is still an invariant cylinder. Okay. The second point to take into account is to study the dynamics inside the cylinder, dynamics in C. So in C, so when I1 is 0 and phi 1 is 0, if we look at the other variables, we get that phi 2 is equal to I2, and I2 is equal to 0, because when phi 1 is 0, this term vanishes. So here we get that inside the cylinder, even for the full system, we have a system which is integrable. We have an extra first integral. So for the perturbation, or let me write this here, we still have this cylinder. And inside, we have a foliation still by 2D to I. But outside, if we look, when we are away from phi 0, phi 1 to 0, I2 changes. So this perturbation breaks the integrability outside. So now, that's C, the stable or the unstable invariant manifold of the system, of the cylinder, intersects or transversally the stable manifold. Okay. So now here, so for the full system, we break integrability. So now the stable manifold and the unstable manifold intersect transversally, which means that if I leave from a leaf of this stable manifold, so I fix here a point, when I leave through one D leaf of the invariant manifold, I can come back to a different point which is higher. If I now I stay sometimes in this torus here, I can choose a different point whose leaf again goes up and then goes down, comes back to a different point. Okay, so what Arnold did was to construct what is called a chain of transition tori, so chain of transition torus tori, which is a sequence of torus in our cylinder such that the unstable manifold of one torus intersects transversely the stable manifold of the next one. Okay. And then, well, I mean, he used a shadowing argument or a lambda lemma to say that actually there is one orbit which more or less follows this this path, I mean, which follows, it's close to this path for all time, and therefore he obtained orbits with growing I. Okay, so here, I mean, he did two tricks. Let's say. So the first trick, so Arnold did two tricks. So the first trick is to take mu much smaller than epsilon, which means to say that that hyperbolicity is much larger than non, if you want that non-integrability. So first I add one term which creates some hyperbolicity, but does not break integrability, and then I add this extra term which breaks integrability. And of course, yes. Yes.
And it's still it could be a product, and then you don't produce any product.
Well, because you don't have enough dimension. That's what you're saying?
The potential is the following. You have the pendulum.
Yes.
And your cylinder is integrable.
Yes.
You produce a first perturbation that breaks the connection of the pendulum.
Yes.
So break the integrability. And still it's a product.
You mean if you have well, I mean, you need to prove that say that the dynamics inside and outside are kind of independent, if you want. That you don't have common invariant curves. Is what that's what you're.
No, yeah.
Yes. Well, because here you just have a population of invariant curves. So as long as you break it outside, since inside it's integrable, you can diffuse. If you break it at both places, let's say in the same way, if you are so unlucky that you break it in the same way, then can be that the behavior outside cancel out with the one inside, and then you don't get progress. That's what you, but I mean, yes. I mean,
go from the unstable manifold of one circle inside, came back to the same circle. So the stable manifold of the circle inside and the stable manifold of the circle outside will coincide.
Yes, yeah.
So it's not just
and you need to check, no, yes. Yeah. I mean, you need to see that what happens inside and outside. It has what's called non-common invariant curves, no? And the second trick that he used is the persistence of a continuum of 2D tori. Right, so here, what he said is that he chose this perturbation in such a way that here you get the foliation of 2D tori even for the full system. Okay, so after Arnold, people of course was trying to prove the same behavior for more general systems, and as the first step, what people tried, they would say, was to keep this assumption, which of course is very strong, and try to drop this one. So then, at some point, it was proposed to, let's say, to to assume still mu below epsilon and generalize Arnold example, right? Or for this similar, instead of using two parameters and proving and using one much more than the other, to say that we take epsilon equal to one and use only mu as a parameter. So we start with a pendulum plus a oscillator, and then we perturb this system. Okay, so this is called usually a priori unstable. And I think that the name comes from Kierkegaard and Galabotti. Contraposed with what is called a priori stable, that is the case which we are dealing with, that is to assume that our first order has it's completely integrable. So a priori stable means that H0 is Liouville-Arnold integrable, so that it's the phase space is foliated by Torrey. So a priori stable, it's harder because you need to create the hyperbolicity instead of having it for free at the first order. So a priori stable would be, let's say, epsilon very small, and mu basically of order one, because when we add a typical perturbation, at first order, we should be getting four harmonics, or most of them, let's say. Here, he just puts one harmonic at the first order, and then all the rest are much smaller. So he's giving some predominance to one harmonic with respect to the others. When we say properly stable, it means that all these terms should be basically for the same order. You add just some perturbation, which contains all four harmonics, okay? But so let me take some minutes, 5 or 10 minutes more, and explain the results that have been obtained for the a priori unstable systems, because what we will get in the single terms regime is very similar from what people got in the a priori unstable systems. So the model, as I say, is just take a pendulum, and this can be, I mean, can be any potential with a maximum, I mean, anything which is pendulum-like, plus an oscillator, plus some perturbation which is, let's say, generic. So let's see what is persistent from this picture and what's not. Of course, when mu is zero, we get precisely what I put here. So we get a cylinder foliated by Torrey, which is I2 equal to constant. Sorry, I2 dot equal to zero, times an integrable pendulum, right? And now we see what happens when we add this perturbation here. So the first thing is that this C, even if it's not persistent as it is, because now this can, I mean, can modify the equation, since it's hyperbolic, it's persistent, which means that, so here we get some C which is deformed for a little bit. So let me write this here. So for mu positive, we get C mu, which is close to C, and is normally hyperbolic. Here we get, again, that the invariant manifolds intersect transversally. But now we want to look at the dynamics inside C. So here, if we take, I mean, here this depends on phi I and time. Here, if we get a Poincaré map induced in the cylinder, what we get is a twist map which is integrable. Which means that here, when we perturb it, we get that the dynamics is a nearly integrable twist map. I mean, this is in the Poincaré section. So, I mean, we know very well what the dynamics of a nearly integrable twist map. So here we get KM dot I, or so 2D KM dot I, and its measure, its full measure minus the square root of the perturbative parameter. So here we get many tori, but at some point we get gaps of size of the square root of mu. If now we want to see what happens outside, so if I take a point, I take the unstable fiber and I come back, I can see that these jams are of order mu. So the distance of Tori is of order the square root of mu, and the homoclinic jams are of size of order mu, which means that if there were an orbit which goes from the bottom to the top of this polycylinder, I mean, we don't know how to do it using Arnold mechanism. I mean, in one torus, if I apply some jam, I get to a torus which is mu closed by the same, and at some point I hit this gap, which is bigger than these jams, but I don't know how to continue. Okay, so this is called is still called the big gaps problem. For obvious reasons. So, and there were basically two methods to overcome it. Let me explain both methods, and I'll finish here. So the idea is that we need to add invariant objects, or let's say we need to add something. Invariant objects in the gaps to be able to diffuse. Okay, so here there were two ideas. One by Abadeu dels Amps, who was here some years ago, de la Llave and Seara. And the other by Cheng and Yang, and we will follow more closely this second approach. So the first one is that, okay, here, what's happening in this gap? So in the gaps, what we encounter are resonances. So actually this here, it's a resonance. So what we get here, it's basically a pendulum-like structure, so some I, like in a pendulum, and here inside there are more tori, as happens in the classical pendulum. Okay? And actually, this tori here, which are called secondary tori, secondary because they have different topology than the original ones. Now, they are not graphs over the base, they are contractible. These tori are mu close to the previous ones. So including, so if we secondary tori, if we include them in the transition chain, we have enough objects to be able to diffuse, right? So we start here in this torus. We make a jam. We go here. We make a jump. We make a jump. Then we hit this one here. We go up all the way. And again here, we make a trip, and I keep the next one. And this is the way we can jump through these test runs. The good thing of this method is that it's very, let's say, explicit. So we know which objects we are putting in our chain. So it's very precise what we are doing. But it needs, it needs regularity. So this is proven doing averaging methods and KAM, and it needs a pretty large regularity. Now I don't remember the number, but it's kind of large. The Cheng and Yang approach is different. And let me cheat a little bit. But so they assume H0 is strictly convex. And again, so they consider the twist map in the cylinder, and they say, okay, besides the classical Torai, one can apply our matter theory, and so one can apply fractional methods. And then, let's say for each rotation number, I mean, you're looking at the map in the cylinder for each rotation number, there exists what is called the Aubrey matter set, which is defined variationally. And basically, they can be of two types. So we have the cylinder. So they either are, they can be a torus, as happens, as the ones we were getting, or they can be something which is not a full graph over the base, meaning that there are holes in between. So this belongs to a Birkhoff zone. So basically, what they suggest is that, well, in case we have enough Torai, we can jump through these homoclinics. When we reach this zone, well, then we can use techniques of the twist maps to travel through them until I hit again one Torai, and then we continue. Of course, this mechanism is more involved than this, but this is the main idea. And then for these methods, they actually need a very low regularity. And that's what we will use, what Vadim and Kay used in the proof. I mean, not precisely Cheng and Yan, but a work by Patrick Bernard, but that in spirit it's very close to this idea here. So what I'm going to explain the next day.
In the variational method, you have the two to write.
Yes.
What is known that you can navigate from the bottom to the top as much closer as you can.
Yes.
Just inside the...
What he said for twist maps is inside this the cylinder. And then what they show is that, of course, when you are shadowing, you need to be outside. But that if you are very close, you can pass through all these Aubrey matter sets. You can go from, one level, let's say, from one level to the next one and jump up until you hit the next Torai. When you hit this Torai, of course, you cannot jump close to the cylinder because that's a barrier, but then you use this homoclinic to make this jump, okay? So what I'm gonna explain the next day is that actually in this a priori stable case, we will get, so in the single resonant regime, we will get a sequence of cylinders So this is the direction of the resonance, which will be similar to the ones I've presented here, but with very low regularity. Actually, there would be what Vadim and Ke call them crumpled cylinders, would be of this type, like this. So there will be, they say, first the tube of a vacuum cleaner, meaning that these angles here, they are going to be of size per square root of epsilon. So they move like, I mean, they are of a very strange shape. So it's, and not even know how is the dynamics in this cylinder. I mean, not even if inside we have a twist map. But still, one can use this modification of this professional method to go through the cylinder and then to connect one to the other. Okay, and that's what I'm going to explain on Monday. And I'll finish here.